Professor Ngobe, let's begin first of all by looking at the numbers that we saw yesterday coming out of the markets. We saw commodity prices tumbling, and I'm just wondering in the back of my mind whether that makes you think again about your growth numbers for the African continent. But give us a broad overview of what you're seeing in terms of the African growth outlook going forward.
What we're seeing sub-Saharan Africa, if I exclude North Africa, is still showing robust growth, almost back to the pre-financial crisis levels, the pre-2009 levels. East Africa is growing the strongest, with Southern Africa growing more modestly, and West Africa also showing some strong growth, including Central Africa. North Africa is going to be the slowest region, mainly because of Libya, a slowdown in Tunisia, revolution in Egypt, so that's going to be grow slowly. So overall, the rate of growth in Africa is going to be lower than we expected last year, this time, because we didn't anticipate the North Africa revolution, frankly.
Okay. So it's still robust.
Our number stand now is that North Africa overall will grow at about 0.7 to 1% compared to our projected of something like 3.5 before. So overall, for the whole of Africa, we expect the numbers to sit just below 4%.
Yeah.
But the exact figures will come out as we launch our African Outlook report at our annual meeting in the first week of June.
Yeah, we're going to come back to that. We saw yesterday oil tumbling as much as 5%. And I'm just wondering at the back of my mind, how low that figure would need to go, or for the overall commodity basket would need to go for you again to begin worrying about whether that will have a big impact on African growth?
The impact of commodities in Africa is going to be mixed, because you do have net oil importers, so they obviously get hurt.
Sure.
And then you've got net oil exporters, who then will also, the net oil importers will benefit because prices are coming down, and the net oil exporters will suffer because the prices are coming down.
Yeah.
So there's some trade-off going on there. Mm. But we know that most governments in oil-producing countries are budgeting on prices of around $80 per barrel.
They've been very conservative.
Or even lower, very conservative. So my feeling is that it can go as low as that. It will still produce a robust growth. Also, there are some countries which have managed to diversify their economies, such as Nigeria, where, for instance, services and agriculture have caught up with the oil sector.
Yeah.
So there's a cushion. But generally, yes, we do worry when commodities tumble, because there's still a large part of African countries that depend on commodity exports.
Absolutely. Sure. Now, one other variable that perhaps may not have been around in your calculations last year is the issue of food prices as well as inflation. We've seen inflation accelerating across most of the continent. We've seen the effects happening in Uganda. We've seen problems in Kenya now, where we've got the whole business sector in uproar because the government is legislating prices, etc. What risk do you see those two, food prices, fuel and inflation, are having on the African economic outlook?
They're definitely a risk to our growth forecast. They're a risk to social order, absolutely. But also, let me say that easily 60% of the inflation you see on the food side is also caused by fuel.
Yeah.
So there's also a transmission mechanism between those two, and they're clearly linked. So it is a risk. We saw a few years ago that there were some routes in Mozambique, in West Africa, around rice prices. So there's always a risk. I think the one thing that governments shouldn't do is try to impose price controls and other market distortionary factors. So that wouldn't work well. What would work better is if there's some kind of transfers to cushion people from this kind of negative impact of inflation and food prices, as opposed to price controls. But quite clearly, that is a risk to our growth forecast and social order.
Absolutely. Now, of course, another risk are the currencies. We have seen some of the currencies coming under pressure. In Kenya, for instance, we have the shilling sitting close to a record low. Here in South Africa, it's the other end of the picture. We see the rand sitting around 675, 676, and exporters, of course, are worried. What advice do you give to governments? Let's begin here in South Africa, for instance, where you have, in some people's minds, an overvalued currency.
Look, right now, and in terms of the global cycle, the rand will be strong. Why? Because if you look at the nature of the fallout of the global financial crisis, capital is flowing into emerging markets. South Africa is one of those. And South Africa is now a BRIC country as well. That has further boost to its image. So naturally, it will attract inflows that then strengthen the currency.
Is it overvalued?
It's difficult to say, but I think that in my view it's too strong to allow South Africa to be competitive in this environment. It's definitely overvalued, but I can't say sitting here to what extent it is. Certainly a weaker currency would be helpful in promoting, you know, a more competitive environment for exports. But it's just so difficult to manage currencies right now under these circumstances when emerging markets are attractive, more attractive than developed markets.
Let's throw forward to Portugal. Next month you're holding your annual meetings with the African Development Bank, and you're launching a special report at that meeting. You're looking at the issue of migration and the diaspora. How important have Africans who have moved away from their domestic markets to the African economies that they left?
In Africa, there are something like 30 million migrants or people who count as diaspora. Two-thirds of those are within Africa itself, something like 18 million. The rest are outside Africa. They bring in per year something like order of $41 to $45 billion a year. That is equal, if not slightly higher than aid that's flowing into Africa. In fact, if you add the diaspora inflows or remittances to foreign direct investment, which is well over 50 billion or so, that far dominates aid to Africa. So it's a significant portion. I think, however, going forward, there should be a way in which we should try to create order into how it comes in, maybe launching diaspora bond or for some other instruments, so that, frankly, a country like Nigeria, where we've got a large diaspora, that's a place where we could start to assist and see how we can launch some instrument, and some other countries as well. But it's a lot of potential in the diaspora, and in my view, that's a potential that should be harnessed orderly.